This screencast will discuss the approximation of higher-order transfer functions as FOPDTs, or first-order plus dead-time transfer functions. We'll first discuss about the reasons why we want to do this, discuss one method by which we can do this approximation, and then carry out an example. So first, the question that might come up about is, I have the transfer function on the left, which is a sixth-order transfer function. Why would I want to do this in the first place? So there are two major reasons to approximate. The first is mathematical in nature, is the fact that the math is easier. So therefore, in trying to do analysis for the FOPDT, it is much easier to do than trying to deal with a sixth-order transfer function. The second reason is the presence of FOPDTs in tuning. In a number of situations, in order to develop the appropriate tuning parameters, whether it be the controller gain k sub c, the integral time tau sub I, or the derivative time tau sub d, oftentimes, in order to use these tuning parameter methodologies, it requires the development of a FOPDT. And if your process is higher order, this can become problematic. So there are a number of methods by which higher order transfer functions can be approximated as FOPDTs. Here we will discuss Skogestad's method. Skogestad is a professor in Norway. So in order to utilize the Skogestad method, there are a few things that have to be done. The first thing that has to be done is the denominator should be in terms of the time constants. In other words, you have to find the respective time constants you have. So we'd want this to become tau 1s plus 1 times tau 2s plus 1, etc. In order to use the Skogestad method, a couple other things have to be true. The first is the fact that a dominant time constant must exist. The dominance of a time constant is the fact that the largest value of tau must be at least 1.5 times greater than the next largest time constant. How well the Skogestad approximation fits hinges very much on this. So therefore, if the ratio between the largest and the next largest is about 1.5, the fit will work, but will not be as good in comparison to a system where the ratio would be 5 or 6 or higher. A third thing to keep into account for the Skogestad method is the fact that the system should be overdamped. In other words, this means the fact that there's no oscillation, so no imaginary roots. And it's a stable system. So in other words, there's no positive root in the denominator, or all the taus are positive. Why do we have this requirement for an overdamped system? Well, the reason comes from thinking about how a FOPDT process behaves. So here, we'll do a quick sketch of a graph of how a FOPDT is affected by a step function. So recall the fact that it looks something along these lines, where if we define our x-axis time and our y-axis as our variable of interest y. Because the response for a FOPDT is overdamped, it must mean in order for a higher order transfer function to be approximated by a FOPDT, it should also be overdamped. Fortunately, from a chemical process standpoint, this is generally not a problem for us to concern ourselves with, so this is generally okay. Why this function works so well is the fact that as we have a whole bunch of time constants in the denominator, that tends to slow down the process, because remember the fact that the denominator indicates dynamics that slow the response down. So we end up generally, as we get to higher order functions, developing at the very beginning something that almost resembles dead time, and then develop some sort of inflection point before reaching the steady state. So an important point to note about any FOPDT approximation, whether it be Skogestad or otherwise, is the fact that the approximation is weakest at short times. But fortunately, since we're often interested in understanding how the dynamics work from beginning to end, this is generally not too much of a problem. But if there is a requirement where we must have significant accuracy at the very beginning, you wouldn't want to make an approximation in the first place. Now that we have looked at the requirements in order to use the Skogestad method, let's actually describe the Skogestad method in terms of how it is able to approximate higher-order transfer functions. So the way it does it is, remember the fact that what we're trying to do is get a FOPDT. So FOPDT is ke to the negative theta s divided by tau s plus 1, where k is the steady state gain, the theta is the dead time, and the tau is the time constant. So here, the Skogestad method needs to find three parameters, k, theta, and tau. We'll start with gain. Gain is the simplest because the gain in the Skogestad is equal to the gain in the higher order. An important point here is making sure the fact that you put the function is in standard form. And if your denominator has everything in tau s plus tau 1 s plus 1 times tau 2 s plus 1 times tau 3 s plus 1, it is in standard form. So therefore, the gain is the gain. For the time constant for the FOPDT from the SCOGA stat, the methodology to find the time constant is you take the largest time constant from your higher order transfer function and add half of the time constant of the next largest. This is why SCOGAstat's method is often referred to as SCOGAstat's half rule. And the dead time is basically incorporated of everything else. So therefore, it represents the other half of the next largest time constant plus the summation of all other taus. An important point to note here is the fact that any taus in the denominator would be positive, but if by chance there is a tau in the numerator and it can be approximated reasonably by a FOPDT, that would be a negative. Finally, we would add any dead time that is already present in the higher order transfer function. So the SCOGA method is not an exceptionally difficult method to allow us to approximate a higher order transfer function as a FOPDT. So what we're now going to do is use these formulas in order to find a FOPDT for a fifth order transfer function. What we're going to do here is find the FOPDT for the transfer function that we have here. Well, first we have to check the criteria for use of SCOGAstat's method. So let's check our criteria. The first is that the function is overdamped. That checks out because we have taus that are all positive. Secondly, we want to make sure the fact that the tau of the largest time constant is greater than or equal to 1.5 times the next largest. In this case, our values here are 8 over 3, something which is greater than 1.5. So those check. Therefore, this SCOGAstat method can be used. So we'll start with evaluating all variables of interest in a FOPDT. We'll start with the gain. The gain is the same gain as our higher order function. So therefore, that's just 6. For the time constant tau, that is the largest time constant plus the half of the next largest time constant from our higher order transfer function. So here, that would be 8 plus 1/2 times 3, or 9.5. Finally, theta will represent half of the next largest tau plus the sum of all other taus plus any dead time that was present in the initial process. So here, we'll take half of 3, because that's the half of the next largest tau. All of the remaining taus we have, if we go back to our equation, we have nothing in the numerator, so therefore this will just be 2, and we have s plus 1 squared, so we have 2 ones there, 2 plus 1 plus 1, plus the value of the dead time which is already there, which is 2. When we add these all together, we get 7.5. So therefore, what this means is that our transfer function for that fifth order function is equal to 6 e to the negative 7.5s divided by 9.5 s plus 1. So you may be asking yourself, you made this approximation, but how good of an approximation is it? So to look at this, both transfer functions were put in to simulate how they would respond to a step function of magnitude 1. Simulink was not the only program you could use. There were a whole host of other programs. Here, we decided to use Simulink. So when we look at the graph from Simulink, what we see is the fact that the difference between the fifth order transfer function and the FOPDT are relatively small, indicating that the approximation is quite valid. As noted before, the biggest difference between the two will happen at low times, mainly caused due to the difference in the dead times for the respective processes. Recall that the fifth order process had a dead time of 2, whereas the FOPDT had a dead time of 7.5. So primarily the reason why you see such a gap at earlier times. But note at long times that the processes both converge to the steady state gain here, which is 6. So through this screencast, hopefully we are able to understand why approximations of higher order transfer functions are necessary and to be able to use a method to make this approximation to develop a FOPDT.